The Office of the Superintendent of Financial Institutions is coming out, or OSFI as they're known rather, they're coming out with some new rules starting January 1st, 2018. The provincial government in Ontario came out with some new policy with respect to housing earlier this year. Did we need more measures?
No. Honest to God, we got to stop this piling on. It seems like every level of government wants to save us from ourselves. Look, I know back in April we had a significant increase in housing prices in the Greater Golden Horseshoe area. Governments would be tempted to intervene. But honest to God, Larissa, since then you've had the province with their fair housing plan and new taxes. The city of Toronto increased the land transfer tax. Mortgage rates have gone up, and now new, tougher rules to get a mortgage for careful savers like you and me. That really has a risk of depressing the market and hurting the broader economy.
Okay, I'm going to be devil's advocate here for a moment. And I believe OSFI was having this conversation because of all these conversations surrounding the increase of household debt. Interest rates are on the rise. Property values are on the rise. So they are being prudent. They're being careful, aren't they? I mean, they don't want to lead us into a housing market meltdown.
It's a pretty heavy hand. And when government plays the heavy hand, the problem is they risk tipping the balance and making things worse. So let me explain. The new rules will be basically applied to the most careful savers, people who have a demonstrated record of paying down their mortgage, who could put down 20% or more. And that means one of two things under these new rules. So if you're looking at buying a home, say around $750,000 in the GTA, now with this new test, you could only afford a home up to $570,000. So people who want to move up, maybe they've got kids now, they're limited. Or the alternative is to go into the secondary market and borrow at higher rates, which means you pay even more interest. So I worry that this is overkill.
So essentially it's going to price people out of the market, is what you're saying?
Big risk. Look, I think right now what people want to have is some stability in the marketplace. We've had a roller coaster, right, in this past year. I think it'd be very prudent for governments at all levels, federal, provincial, and municipal, to take a wait-and-see attitude, basically to pump the brakes and stop trying to intervene in the housing market, because I worry they're going to grind it to a halt.
So we have seen a little bit of a slowdown in some of these hot housing markets, and we typically think of Toronto and Vancouver. But I'm curious to know what happens to markets in Atlantic Canada. What happens to markets, to the housing market in Alberta? I mean, who are just slowly trying to, you know, get it together and come up on the rise. How do these measures affect them?
Harshly. There's no instrument that the federal government has that would be a Toronto and Vancouver only policy. So if they apply something to the Toronto market or Vancouver, it impacts on Sudbury or Fort Erie or St. John, New Brunswick. And in those areas where housing prices are flatter, the economy is nowhere near as strong, it could really capsize the market and then undermine the value of the biggest value of investment the middle class have. You could actually see home prices negatively impacted in those regions from a heavy instrument from government.
I think some of the other unintended consequences, and we've been hearing about this, is also pushing these people to credit unions, which are not federally regulated. They're provincially regulated, and that's another conversation. And there's also pushing these people to unregulated banking, which is that shadow banking, if you will. Will that have a detrimental effect?
There's a risk. I mean, the credit unions, I will say, they're very strong in the province of Ontario. There's good regulatory measures run by the province. I can say that as a former cabinet minister that was in on those decisions. But when you're talking about the secondary market, the gray market, there may be folks right now who are trying to move up because they just had a kid who will say, well, they're no longer going to qualify for that family home. They'll go to the secondary market. And that means they're paying much higher mortgage rates as a result. It means less money going into the home, more money going into the lenders at the end of the day. Honest to God, Larissa, the best approach governments could take, add housing supply. Give us more choices and greater variety in the marketplace. That's the way to ensure home ownership stays affordable, not the heavy hand that could capsize the whole market.
At some point, I knew you were going to say it comes down to supply, which is ultimately what it is, right? And the missing middle. Addressing that entire component is the seed to this whole conversation. What should have OSFI done? What should they have done?
I would have, for OSFI, the regular that sets the rules around mortgage, they already made a move a few months ago. Mortgage rates have gone up because interest rates have gone up. My view to them, to stay on the sidelines, just take a wait-and-see approach for a little while. Don't keep piling on. Now, the provincial and federal governments have a role to play in adding housing supply. In fact, I was just at a speech by the Minister of Municipal Affairs. I talked to him about this. The province can play a role in speeding up the approvals process. It is a dead weight of regulation and expense. It slows everything down. The longer the delay, the more expensive the house is at the end of the day.
Cutting down that red tape.
You got it. You can intensify along rail lines like subways and GO Transit. They're making good investments there. Why not allow for higher rises around those buildings? A lot of Canadians would kill to live above a subway or a GO station and then commute to work every day.